Friends, I think we'll go ahead and get started if we can. Folks, plenty of room up front. I'm Paul Prippenow, the president here at Augsburg, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the Spring Sabo Center Symposium, Climate Change After Paris, How Do We Get There? For many of us, we were here last fall when we started this conversation with a panel that was called Economics and the Environment, a conversation about Pope Francis's encyclical. And then, of course, Paris happened, and now we're here a couple months later to hear from our distinguished panel on what the work is ahead. So we're so proud of our Sabo Center for Democracy and Citizenship and its staff and many students who every day are living out our mission here at Augsburg, on our community and the campus, in our neighborhood, around our cities and around the world. And certainly one of the issues that is utmost in our minds here as a campus community and as a country and in our global society is the issue of environmental sustainability and climate change, so a very, very fitting topic for this evening. I have just one quick announcement that I'd like to make before I turn the podium over to our Sabo fellow, distinguished fellow, Tom Berg, and that is that tomorrow evening, right here in this space, we will have the pleasure of welcoming Congressman Keith Ellison, who will be with us at the invitation of our student government. So he'll be here at 6 p.m. Here in the chapel, and that is an event that is open to the public. So if you are so inclined, please come back and join us tomorrow night at 6 to be with Congressman Ellison. So now it's my pleasure to introduce Tom Berg. Tom?
Thank you very much, Paul, and welcome to everybody for this Sabo Symposium here. And before we get into the program, I just want to make one mention that our usual chief architect and advocate for these gatherings, Martin Sabo, couldn't make it tonight. Martin had a bit of a problem with a breathing situation, but I'm very pleased to report that he is doing very well today, and we fully expect him to be back here, sitting down here, asking some hard questions at the next symposium that we have. And Paul mentioned about we had the last symposium in October was the encyclical, the environment and economics, and we had a pretty lively and fun discussion. And then in December, we had what I think many, many people thought was a most amazing meeting, and I think one or two of our panelists were at attendance at that meeting in Paris with, I think, about 187 countries, virtually all of the countries in the world, who, as I understand it, produce about 99% of the emissions that we're worried about with climate change. And at that, and hopefully some will mention a little bit about that meeting and the international goals that were established, the transparency that was made, agreed to, and the reporting mechanisms for those things. But so that was all done, and it was a pretty exciting time, I think, in world diplomacy and things. But now we're, how do we get there is the topic for tonight. And the we that we want to focus on right now is the we in Minnesota. And we have some three excellent speakers here to talk to us about that. And I'm going to introduce all of them right now. And then we'll just go one, two, three with their speaking. They'll have 10, 11, 12 minutes to talk about this. And then we'll follow our usual format with questions, and we've got people with microphones here, and we usually start out with the students for sure get the first question or two, so I hope those of you who are students will be thinking about those as we go forward. So I'll do this in the order they're going to speak. Our first speaker is Ellen Anderson, who is currently the executive director of the University of Minnesota Energy Transition Lab. She has spent time prior to that as a senior advisor on energy and the environment to Governor Dayton, and she has been chair of the Public Utilities Commission here in Minnesota, and is a, what, 19-year, 18? 18 years, a veteran of the Minnesota State Senate and was a champion of environmental legislation and has an awesome record of working in that area. She has a BA from Carleton College and a JD from the University of Minnesota Law School. And the second speaker tonight is not Amy Fredrigal, who was on the program earlier, but a colleague of her, Julia Eagles, who is a regulatory policy specialist at Xcel Energy. And before joining Xcel, she spent 8 years working in the local energy and environmental industry. She has a master's degree in public policy from the Humphrey School of Public Affairs and a bachelor's degree in environmental studies and geography from McAllister College. And for those of you students who are interested in some of the things, particularly in the local scene and opportunities, you might want to try to corral her afterwards, because she's had a wealth of experience in that, I think is quite interesting. And our last speaker is Ann Hunt. She is the Environmental Policy Director in the office of Mayor Chris Coleman in St. Paul. She has served as an Environmental Program Coordinator and contractor with the Minnesota Environmental Partnership. For those of you who work in the field at all, MEP. She's also been with the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources and the Mississippi Relief Program, a Big River Cleanup Program. She was the executive director of the St. Paul Neighborhood Energy Consortium. She has a BA in English from the University of Minnesota. So we've got a wealth of speakers with a variety of different perspectives to hopefully educate us a little bit and answer your questions and get into some dialogue after they're done about how do we get there after this stunning performance in Paris. Ellen, let's start with you. And you can either do from there or from up the podium.
Oh, this is just fine, I think, if it's all right. Are you guys going to sit down? Or do you want to stand up? I'm comfortable just sitting, so I think I'll just stay right where I am. And I assume you can all hear me. Okay, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me, and pleasure to be on the panel with some really wonderful people that I've worked with over the many years. Can I say that Julia was one of my interns when I worked for the Dayton administration, and now she's gone on to bigger and better things. And Anne and I, well, we'll talk about that when you talk about Paris. We can talk about adventures in Paris. And Tom, thank you so much for your leadership and for bringing us together here. So this is a great topic, and I want to start off the conversation. I think my part is to really talk about what happened in Paris, why does it matter? What does it have to do with the U.S., and what does it have to do with Minnesota? And kind of lay that foundation out for you, and then I hope after we each give our presentations, we're going to have plenty of time, as Tom said, to really talk about what does this mean for all of us in our communities, in our colleges, here at home. What can we do about this? But I'm going to start with kind of the information. So, and I think it's really appropriate on a day like today to think about the fact that we broke yet another weather record here in Minnesota, and it was lovely in Minnesota to have such a nice warm day, but it also makes me and maybe many of you uncomfortable thinking about how fast things are changing and how fast we're breaking records, and that in February, when normally we would have had snowstorms, we had rain. And so the new normal is changing so quickly that it just concerns me about what it is going to look like in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, long after I'm gone and you guys are still here, those of you who are of a younger generation than myself. So we have an urgent problem. And it was amazingly, it was a transformative experience for me to be able to be in Paris at the climate talks, where the world came together finally to say we are going to take action about this issue and we're going to do it now. And I want to say first of all that the Paris Agreement, while it was a transformational and enormously important, agreement and process, it's really, it's not the end of the road nor the nor just the beginning of a, it's a step along the way. And really the day after the conference ended was really the beginning of getting to work to make this happen. What made this climate conference unique is that it's really all about how each of us in our own countries and in our own communities are going to enable progress towards the goals that were set in Paris. So let me explain. So the UN has something called the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. No terminology in the UN is simple, but that's called the UNFCCC, and they created something called the Conference of the Parties. And the conference, and this was back in 1990 when they started this, and all these countries of the world said, we need to do something about climate change. And every year, the Conference of the Parties, or the COP, has a meeting to talk about how we're going to get there. And you'll note that the Paris Agreement last December was the COP 21. So it was the 21st year of this group meeting and trying to come up with an agreement. And it finally happened. So, you know, we think the U.S. Congress is slow at reaching consensus. This took a long time. But what they did was do things differently to get to this agreement. So in previous years, what had happened was there was something called the Kyoto Protocol that was agreed to, and in the 1990s, this was ratified by all the countries, but not all of them, not the U.S., but ratified by a number of countries. And it was a top-down kind of approach. It said that thou shalt reduce emissions, countries that sign this, a certain amount. And it also said that the developed countries, the ones that have really put the most carbon dioxide and the most carbon pollution out in the atmosphere, were responsible for making the emissions, and that the poorer countries that are really experiencing the impacts but didn't cause them so much didn't have to do as much. So that approach is what the UN did before. And it had limited results, limited effectiveness. What happened this time around was a whole new way of approaching it. And so in previous years, the U.S. said, we're not going to sign the Kyoto Protocol, we're not going to agree to these limits, UN, because we want everyone to be at the table. We want China and India to be at the table, and we're not going to agree until they are. And the rest of the world looked at the U.S. and said, U.S., you've been the biggest carbon polluter in history and put most of the emissions out there previously, so we're not going to be at the table if you're not at the table. So it was kind of like, you know, who's going to go first? And what happened in the last year or two in the build-up to this Paris Agreement, to COP21, was a couple of big things. Number one, President Obama went to China, and President Obama went to India, and the leaders of those countries sat down and said, we all agree we're going to reduce emissions. So China made a binding agreement, India made a binding agreement, and in the U.S., the U.S. put out a rule coming from the Clean Air Act called the Clean Power Plan that said that we are going to reduce carbon emissions from coal plants, from power plants across the U.S. And that plan was what made the rest of the world say the U.S. is finally serious about reducing emissions. Without that legal rule coming through the U.S. system, there was skepticism that the U.S. was actually going to do anything. So that was a pivotal part of getting this world agreement to happen, that the U.S. came with a plan. And what's also different about this COP21, this UN agreement, was that it was a bottom-up strategy instead of a top-down thou shalt. Instead, every country came to the table and said, here's our plan that we've figured out in our own country what is legally possible, what's politically possible, and what's, you know, kind of economically and technically possible. And we put our own plan together of how we're going to reduce carbon emissions and move towards clean energy and make an energy transition. And we're going to do it in a way that works for our country and its people. And every country came with those commitments. And so what happened when this agreement happened in Paris was that everybody said, okay, here's our agreement, here's our promises, but the agreement itself, the legally binding part of this Paris agreement, is not each country's plans. The legally binding part says that we're all gonna promise to monitor each other and to come back and report on our progress and to be transparent about each of our country's progresses and to promise to come back and ratchet up our ambition in a few years and do that continually. Because the other thing about the Paris Agreement is that everybody agreed who was there, we need to do this, and we're gonna move forward, but they also agreed it's not enough. Because the Paris Agreement says we're all gonna agree to try to reduce emissions to less than 2 degrees increased warming over this century, by the end of this century. And we're gonna work really hard to even get to 1.5 degrees warming by the end of this century. But it's not enough, according to scientists, to turn around the worst impacts of climate change. Okay, so that's the Paris Agreement. I mentioned the Clean Power Plan. That's sort of the US, the biggest marquee part of our commitment to get there. What does this mean for Minnesota? And let me conclude with that. So when the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, put together the Clean Power Plan, they used Minnesota as one of their models. They said Minnesota has one of the best systems in the country that's figured out how to reduce carbon pollution from its energy sector in a very effective, cost-effective way that works. And what we've done in Minnesota is we passed some big laws. In 2007, we passed a renewable energy standard that requires about, well, for XL, 30%, for the rest of the state, 25% renewable electricity. And now we added on to that for solar energy. So roughly our law says 28% of our electricity has to come from renewable sources by 2025. And we're right now at 21%. So we're moving fast forward because 15 years ago, it was like this much. And we also figured out how to reduce energy waste. So be more efficient and save money that way. So we've avoided building about a dozen power plants because we've saved energy. And we've also passed a law in Minnesota that says we're gonna reduce our carbon pollution from all across the economy, not just from electricity, but from transportation, from agriculture, from buildings, from industry. Now on that piece, and this is where I'll end, because this kind of poses the big challenge, our law, sorry I'm spewing numbers, but our carbon reduction law, our greenhouse gas emissions targets in Minnesota say we're gonna reduce across our whole state carbon emissions 15% by 2015. Guess what, it's 2016 and we didn't meet that 15% reduction. We met it in the electricity part of our energy world. We've done a great job there. We're over, you know, we're ahead of schedule, but on all the other pieces, we have a ways to go. Our next target is 30% reduction by 2025 and 80% reduction by 2050. That's our big challenge. We have to get there. That's our part that makes us part of a global solution, and we have to make sure we're gonna get there. I can talk more about what Minnesota is doing. Am I out of time?
Keep going.
Okay, two more minutes. So what's Minnesota doing to get there, to reach these bigger goals? I talked about some of the laws we passed in 2007, and what's been happening at the state level is an effort to figure out all the different steps to try to ramp up our ambition here at the state level to reduce carbon pollution and carbon emissions, not just from electricity, but from transportation, as I mentioned, from all those different sectors. And so what the state is doing right now is kind of studying in a way that's gonna provide some really helpful information. And they're gonna release in the next few months their analysis that says, if we did, you know, we're gonna study like 20 different things, if we did all these different things, could we reach our goal? And how much would it cost? And how many jobs would it create? So part of what has been the story in Minnesota is that we're building a clean energy economy. We're creating green jobs. We've created 15,000 jobs in the clean energy sectors in the last 10 years or so. since we started really working on this. And if you want to look at that information in more detail, you can find it on a state website. I can give you more information about that. But it's good to know that in these different sectors of clean energy across Minnesota, solar, wind, bioenergy, smart grid, and energy storage, and clean technology, and things like that, energy efficiency, not only have we created 15,000 jobs, but these are some of the best paying jobs that are being created in today's economy and the fastest growing sectors of job growth. So for all of you who are, you know, in the millennial generation, you know, just starting out your careers or still in school and trying to figure out what you're going to do, these jobs have high opportunity and high growth potential going forward. And so what we're trying to do is figure out how to grow that clean energy economy, meet our climate goals, and think positive, create jobs, create wealth in our communities, produce more of our own energy. Because Minnesota, we have a lot of wind, we have a lot of solar, even though we're a northern state. We have a lot of agricultural products and forests and water. We can produce energy with so many of those resources. But one thing we don't actually have in our state is any fossil fuel resources. We have no natural gas reserves, we have no coal, we have no uranium. We import all of that. And so if you think about producing our own energy sources out of our own resources, we have enough wind that we can export it to the nation. We could do the same thing with many other renewable energy resources. We can become an energy exporter as we move towards a clean energy economy. So that is the really good news. There's a lot of opportunity in this energy transition. So it's not all gloom and doom, and there's things that we can do to make a difference. So maybe I'll stop there, and we'll talk more about some of those pathways to make a difference as we get into a conversation. Thank you.
Julia, either here or up here. What's up here?
See your slides, yeah.
And I'll try not to use those if I have a question.
Great, well thank you. And I'm excited and humbled here to be included in this panel. On International Women's Day, Ellen and I were talking before we got in here, how many great women there are working in the industry here, so woohoo! And I was sort of a last minute stand in here, but excited to tell you a little bit about what we're doing at Xcel Energy to sort of build on what Ellen spoke about. So just to give some background, and I have more detail here about our process than we'll have time for, but so Xcel Energy is a regulated utility. We operate in 8 states across the country. My focus is primarily in our, what we still call our Northern States Power Territory, so the 5 states in the upper Midwest where we operate. And we kind of do operate in smaller sub-companies in that way, so I'll be really representing that upper Midwest territory. So it's been an exciting past year for Xcel Energy too, just in terms of what plans we're making for what our generation fleet is going to look like in the next few years, because for us that's sort of the biggest way that we impact emissions. We do this planning for what our system is going to look like every, we look out 15 years, we're supposed to file these every 2 to 3 years. For us it's been more like 5 since we filed the last one. And as Ellen well knows, having served on the Public Utilities Commission, so we're a regulated utility, and we have to come forward with these proposals for approval. So we put forth our resource plan to say what we're proposing for the next 15 years, but it's not yet approved. And once we get approval for that, there's more steps to figure out how we're going to implement it. I would just say that we've been a leader for a long time in clean energy. We're the number one wind energy utility in the country for 11 years running. We have to say that anytime we speak. We're very proud of that. And have quite a few programs that I'll touch on a little bit, just responding increasingly to customer interest in having more clean energy options in our generating fleet. But a lot of that is really driven by our resource plan, so I'm going to flip through sort of an overview of that. So we have a process for resource planning that involves a lot of analysis. So we look at what our system needs are, so how much energy we're going to need based on our load, and then what our options are in terms of existing resources, but also future potential resource additions to meet that need. And so a lot of that is driven by How we're going to reach that is not just sort of matching megawatt for megawatt what our need is, but also complying with those policies that Ellen spoke about at a state level and at a federal level, and increasingly sort of at a community level in terms of responding more to what our communities, our cities, and Anne will speak more to that, what their expectations are too. But our resource plan, we have to comply with what our state requirements are in terms of environmental performance, renewable energy, some of those things. And we put out a plan that we think is the most cost-effective way to meet those obligations and also our needs. And then it goes before the Public Utilities Commission, which is the piece we're at right now. So it's a 15-year plan, and we take into account a lot of considerations around that. So we're doing all this in a planning landscape and a policy environment where a lot is changing and evolving, but we have a number of different priorities that we're managing. We're always looking at reliability. We always want to manage customer cost impacts, but we also certainly want to help to achieve those state and federal policy goals and really respond to what our customer interests are with that plan. So this piece, we do a modeling process that involves looking at a set of assumptions in terms of what we think costs are going to look like in the next 15 years. We look at a number of different scenario options in terms of resource additions, and then we sort of test those scenarios against a number of different sensitivities to really try to plan for the fact that we only know what we know today. We don't know what the system's going to look like in 15 years. We're at a time of immense change in the energy industry right now. So we're trying to manage for that to some degree. We're also recognizing that we'll be submitting another plan here soon, in the next 2 to 3 years. These are sort of some of the main key cost assumptions that we take into account. We do a set of scenarios. I would just say on this piece, we manage for a 5-state region, and so we have some really different state priorities. So Ellen talked about a lot of the leadership in Minnesota. We have most of our service territories in Minnesota, but we also have territory in South Dakota and North Dakota, Wisconsin and Michigan. And those states are taking a different approach, particularly with some of the uncertainty around the Clean Power Plan. So we do have to comply with some of their requirements, which in North Dakota requires looking at a scenario that includes no additional renewables and no externality costs. These are just some of the sensitivities that we sort of manage for, and I'm sorry, I'm gonna go through this pretty quickly. But so what we put together, what we filed initially in January of 2015 was a plan for the next 15 years. That took place at a time, like I said, when there's a lot of changes in the industry generally. Changing economics, more and more interest from customers around clean energy, new technology options coming out, and then when we first filed that plan, the Clean Power Plan was just in its draft form. We got more certainty later in the year, and then now we're in the midst of a stay on the Clean Power Plan, and so, like I mentioned, some of the states aren't moving forward. So it's certainly been an evolving and changing policy environment that we've been working in. Like I said, we filed in January of 2015, and then we did a pretty significant update to that plan in October of 2015, and that's what I'll be talking more about, is sort of our revised proposal that included a pretty major change in terms of one of our largest coal plants. So the plan broadly really looks to accelerate our transition as a utility from coal generation to more zero carbon resources, but also preserving our system stability. Like I said, that's always something that's a top priority for us, is reliability. We're also looking at pursuing gains in energy efficiency and really looking to do more around grid modernization. So that's something we could talk more about, but basically how we make our grid more responsive and sort of smarter, allowing us to have better communication and integrate things like battery storage and more renewables, and then always ensuring customer benefits. So this is sort of the picture of what our energy mix might look like under our plan. So right now, Ellen mentioned that statewide we're at 21% renewable energy. For Xcel Energy, we're at 25%. So our goal for the state is a little bit higher, but we're making really good progress towards that. And with this plan, we're proposing to get to 63% carbon-free electricity, so up to 35% by 2030. And you can really see that shift in terms of dramatically reducing the percent coal that's part of that mix, increasing natural gas as one of our options, but also really investing a lot in renewable energy to maintain that diversity of our energy mix, which is something that's important to us. So just to highlight this piece again, we're getting to 35% renewables, and there's some federal tax credits around renewable energy that have really made it cost effective to add renewables now. So we're looking at adding 1,200 megawatts of renewable energy by 2020. And just to give a picture of what that means, I think that as of 2014, we had something like 13 megawatts of solar on our system, and we're looking at increasing that to more like 800. So it's exponential growth by 2020 in the short term. So just huge, huge growth of renewables, which is going to pose some real challenges, but also some real opportunities, as Ellen was speaking to. So one of the major components of that is shutting down two units of our largest coal plant. So we have a plant called the Sherburne County Sherco plant that is in Becker, Minnesota, and so we're proposing to retire two coal units at that site, which is really what accounts for the significant carbon emissions reduction and that real transition away from coal as part of the plan. But it also introduces some issues in terms of reliability and impacts on our transmission system, and so that's something that we need to do some significant analysis on. We do have obligations to maintain reliability of our transmission system from our regional grid operator and from some federal requirements. So we have to think very carefully about how we make that transition. Again, we're proposing to close down some coal plants depending how the Clean Power Plan goes forward. Potentially around the region, we'll be taking down quite a few of these base load generating plants. So these really big centralized plants, which is sort of what our grid was built on. So it makes a big impact that we need to anticipate and plan for. So that's something I could talk more about, but is a major component of our plan. In terms of the numbers, this is what we're looking at by 2030. So those two units of Sherco are 1,400 megawatts of coal, adding 1,800 megawatts of wind and 1,400 megawatts of solar, and this is all by 2030. Adding a couple different natural gas plants, and then right now maintaining our Prairie Island and Monticello nuclear plants. So we're assuming that those will continue through their license terms, which is in the early 2030s. That's sort of an assumption of our current plan, but it's something that we're starting to have a conversation about, is what is the future of our nuclear fleet? It's a big question. Oh, I must have pushed that button. You told me not to. So this is the exciting piece for me. This is an exciting graph that just shows what our carbon emissions reductions look like. So basically, we had a plan we submitted in January. Our business as usual case, basically not changing a whole lot, just doing the minimum that we needed to comply. That's what that black line looks like. So that gets us between 20 and 25% carbon emissions reduction. What we proposed in January of 2015, before we had sort of the final information about the Clean Power Plan and before we had gotten our first round of stakeholder input, was a plan that got us to about 40%. But what we updated as of October 2015 and then provided some more data on just here in January was this purple line, which is our current plan that includes shutting down those two units at Sherco. That gets us to nearly 60% carbon emissions reduction by 2030. So just a really significant impact that we think would position us really well for compliance with what we knew of the Clean Power Plan at that time and what our state requirements would be. So a pretty bold vision. And then right now we're sort of in the midst of determining what's going to come next, what might change at a federal level in terms of policy, what the commission's decision might be on this plan, and how then we figure out how to implement it. So it's an interesting time. I will say that there's a lot of uncertainty right now for how we're going to move forward, because we rely on those federal requirements and our state requirements to really drive sort of what we need to do going forward, and again, how our states are going to comply. So we're really trying to figure out right now how we work across states. Minnesota is moving forward, continuing to move towards our state implementation plan for the Clean Power Plan. The other states in our system are not, and so that really does leave us in a bit of a challenging situation in terms of how we're going to move forward. So it's interesting and exciting. I think we've laid out a really bold vision. We're proud as a utility to be a leader nationally in terms of putting this plan out there. But it'll be interesting to see how things come together over the next few months and the next year to really figure out what implementation of that plan looks like. Not too over time.
Thank you. Well, let's hear what St. Paul has to say.
Yes, sir.
We're doing well?
We're doing well.
All right. Thank you. Well, thank you all very much for having me here tonight. I'm honored. I know that Gary Hesser and his wife, Nancy Holmans, is a colleague of mine in the mayor's office. I was fortunate to be appointed by the mayor, and he was first elected mayor in 2006 to be the city's first sustainability environmental policy person in the city. And the mayor really wanted to focus on climate change. That was one of the priority things that he outlined in his administration. He felt at that time that there wasn't a lot of action happening at the state and the federal level or the international level on climate change, and really felt that the local level was where you could impact and make real change for some of these bigger, more complex issues. And so that's been a focus of the administration for the last 10 years. So I wanted to hit on a couple of highlights. How many people live in St. Paul or grew up in St. Paul? Some, all right, Lars, we've got some folks here. So that's great. I, of course, always had to put the Mississippi River, and we'll come back into it. That's one of my deep passions, and was one of the reasons why the mayor went to the mayor. I accompanied the mayor, and we went to Paris for the climate change talks. But so we focused for the last year, 10 years, on really sustainability, and it's been a multi-pronged approach to protect our air, water, and our urban landscape, and we've had a whole number of different activities. I admit I had to condense my talk that usually takes me 45 minutes or an hour to 12 minutes, and Tom's going to come and give me the hook. So, but just a couple things to set some stage for us. And as a sustainability director in a city, I'm really fortunate that I get to focus on proactive things that we can do to make our city better. We were very fortunate that Xcel Energy, through a lot of different activities, I think in 2007, knocked a coal-burning power plant down in St. Paul. The top picture is the new combined cycle natural gas facility, but that really significantly reduced our overall carbon emissions in the city. And so, I get to focus. A lot of my colleagues around the country are still trying to fight with their utilities to shut their coal-burning power plants down, and we've already been able to work together and accomplish that. And it significantly, you know, the purpose was to reduce the mercury emissions, but it had significant reductions in particulate matter and CO2. The lower picture is of our district energy facility. It is a combined heat and power plant. It burns biomass in St. Paul primarily, about 75% of its biomass. They're going to have a transition to moving completely to renewables. We also have a hydroelectric facility that used to operate and power the Ford Motor Company. So when Julia was talking about where the trends are going in the industry, is they're moving away from big baseload, you know, facilities to what they call more distributed generation, so smaller sites that are able to power the needs of the facility. The district energy, you know, serves about 80% of downtown, and it primarily uses urban wood waste, so all that emerald ash borer trees that we've had in the area, that's what gets chipped up and burned there. We've also transitioned to a lot of solar projects. We were, with Minneapolis, designated a Solar America City in 2009. That helped us do research and push forward some solar projects. So the top picture is a big solar thermal, so solar hot water that's on the River Center complex, our big convention center. The bottom picture is a solar PV on a parking ramp at the River Center. But we've been able to do a lot of different projects and scale, from electric car charging stations to solar thermal for our swimming pool and stuff. And we've also been able to do a lot of building efficiency, and again, I was just trying to get a couple of highlights, but we have focused a lot with the federal stimulus project we did in 2009 through 12. I think we did more than 110 energy efficiency projects in city buildings, reducing our energy consumption to close to 30%. And we've had some new projects last year. The
And so we've really been trying, the mayor really wanted to make sure we were reducing our fixed expenses and, you know, paying or using taxpayers' money well. The bottom picture is a picture of the green roof on our fire station. We're also one of the few cities in the state, that has a green building policy. So any of our public buildings or buildings that get any public money, more than $200,000 or more, has to comply with a green building policy. So we're really trying to make sure that we're building buildings smarter, and that's had significant savings for us. So climate change. This was a thing from the EQB, the Environmental Quality Board. But I mean, I think what the climate scientists are saying that we'll be seeing increased temperatures, primarily in the winter months, so warmer winters, but also in the summer. We'll see more extreme weather, and we're also going to have higher dew points. So in the summer, for example, when you used to count on that cool night, when you get a little relief, we probably won't be having those much anymore. And so that's going to impact our ability to work and live and play and our activities in the state. Some of the climate science from the last 50 years has showed, you can read these yourselves, but we've had an increase in the temperature. We've had an increase in the growing season, which may be beneficial for a number of farmers, but I think a number of them are also thinking the unpredictability of the growing season is going to be really hard. So if we had, you know, like right now, we're going to look like we may be heading into an early spring. They might be planting, but then we would get a frost or something like that, and that would be severely impact them. And so the unpredictability of the climate is really going to be impacting us. So this is just a kind of a quick thing of where we're going to be going. Great, we've been working with Great Lakes, GLESA is what they're called, but they've been doing a lot of studying and modeling for the climate in Minnesota and the Wisconsin areas. So a little bit more on our history is the city of St. Paul and Minneapolis both joined this International Council of Local Environmental Initiatives in like 1992 on the Kyoto Protocols to talk about how could we as cities be working together and internationally to reduce our climate impacts. When the mayor first started in his office, the U.S. Conference of Mayors had an initiative started by Mayor Bloomberg out of Seattle that was called the Conference of Mayors Climate Protection Agreement, and that outlined some things. And the newest one now, I think the one in 2006 was really good, although we didn't have really good metrics. And I think, as Ellen had talked about, some of the outcomes and goals out of the climate talks this year was to really try to have really transparency. And so the mayor of St. Paul, we passed, he signed the Compact of Mayors right before the Paris talk, and we passed a resolution to the city council. But we're going to be teaming up with, well, as of today, there were 461 cities around the world that are going to be putting all of their data into the same kind of databases. And so one of our goals is going to be, in the first phase, is to do a greenhouse gas inventory both for the entire city. So that's all the buildings, and we'll be able to look at what is the information for residential, commercial, and industrial classes. But then we have to also look at the transportation sector and at the waste sector. So all these cities will be putting that data in a way that everybody will be able to see. Then we need to do, so the greenhouse gas inventory is one of the steps. We'll also be doing an analysis of some of the vulnerabilities that we have in the city. And then we're going to be setting some targets for reduction. So we'll be doing that by customer class or by, you know, residential and commercial and industrials, and have some goals, kind of what Ellen had talked about. And then be also able to do a more comprehensive energy plan and a resiliency plan for our city. So we were excited to be participating with that. There was more than 100 cities in the United States signed that compact before the Paris talks. And I think there was about 40 mayors, U.S. mayors, that went to Paris. So this was a picture. Oh, I don't have a pointer. My guy's on your right, or yeah, your right kind of. Midway up east, just kind of off there. But we had the mayor of Paris hosted a convening for mayors around the world about what their activities were and about this compact. So a number of them are standing on the steps in the Paris City Hall. So what does that mean? I threw this one in too. Just trying to be clear, we're kind of shifting from what we would call mitigation strategies, how can we reduce our greenhouse gas emissions, to now more of the adaptation. We know that climate change is impacting the city. Anybody that lived in the city 2 winters ago and you saw the potholes after the freeze and thaw condition of our city, mayor kind of jokes that one of his first official acts was to do a refrigerated ice rinks in St. Paul. He loves to play hockey, and we couldn't have the predictability of ice. So, you know, all the things that I first talked about is kind of our mitigation strategy. And we're going to continue to do that, and we're going to set some aggressive goals and work with our partners with Excel and our Chamber of Commerce and Center for, you know, all nonprofit partners and things like that. But we really are trying to now shift more towards the adaptation pieces. What is that going to mean for our city? So we were fortunate to get a small grant from the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency, and we started some kickoff meetings. We've been having a number of other agencies in the city. Being the capital city, we're fortunate to have a lot of state agencies and local regional agencies. We also have things like a small reliever airport, Holman Field. We have a port that does all the shipping, you know, by barges there. We have a couple of utilities. We have you know, a number of hospitals, college campuses, and stuff. So this is kind of the phases that we've been going. I'll move a little faster. But we set up four working groups. The top one with the top one there is the economy and social well-being. Then we have a committee that's working on health responses and emergency response. Then really looking at our aging infrastructure, which is going to be one of our most challenges. And then how do we protect our natural resources? So we've had been working on this for a bit. As I said, it's been kind of driven by a lot of our partner agencies. We're going to be releasing a draft of it later this summer. I wanted to be able to have, call it a straw dog, but at least have a draft that we could have people be able to comment on it as opposed to kind of starting all from scratch. But it's been a really great activity. Oh, I put these out of order. So our committees have identified these as some of the major shocks that we're going to have in St. Paul. You know, the Rockefeller Foundation and some other folks identify shocks as something that's going to happen really quickly and suddenly in your community. So it's either going to be the big rainstorm. I know XL, was it in 2014, had, you know, 620,000 customers were out because of a huge, big storm, a windstorm that knocked out power in a lot of the metropolitan area. It was, as I understand, you guys had a playbook for 500,000 as your kind of what they thought would be their worst case scenario, and it was 20% worse than that. So, you know, we've had a lot of flooding, and actually St. Paul is actually really good at handling flooding. We've had that a lot. But, you know, we're going to have the infrastructure potential failure or slope failure. That one picture is the Minneapolis 35E bridge, but then the blizzards. But some of our stressors, these are more long-term systemic things that are going to be problems in our community that are also going to be things that are going to be impacted with climate change. Our aging infrastructure, you know, we're digging up some streets this year where we have, you know, water mains that are 100 years old. I think the inequity and poverty in our communities, you know, continues to be something we need to be paying attention to. Climate change is going to impact more disproportionately poor and low-income people of color, and our invasive species and transportation pieces. So those are some of the things that we're looking at. We are in our groups trying to think about solutions. So what are some kind of cross-cutting things like green infrastructure? We may be able to handle stormwater but also have more mature trees. We can handle the stormwater if we have the big rain events. We can help grow trees. The top picture was a kind of a diagram. I'm sorry, I was kind of throwing that in, but when we did the green line, we did a really innovative project where we were able to treat stormwater from the street and irrigate the trees, and the idea is that we'll get these mature trees with big canopies. Our typical boulevard tree only lasts about 7 years, and that will be able to pull pollutants out, but then also reduce the heat island, you know, in a major corridor. So we're trying to look at some of those kind of cross-cutting solutions that we could do in our community. So we're finalizing our framework. We're going to work on a communication plan. I told you we're going to be doing some outreach. So that's some of the activities that we have. I've been working on a lot of grant proposals lately to do this work. I mean, we with all the cities, I think one of the questions Tom had raised for us is, what are some of the challenges for this? We're a big city, but we're not. You know, our budgets are really tight, and trying to get people to be doing this more planful thing. I mean, usually, you know, they're have the agenda right straight up in front of them. You know, it's like trying to figure out how do we get the plows out on a snow emergency or some of those things. So really spending this time to do the planning and kind of do the scenario planning of what we might be impacting our community. And we're really doing some interesting projects with McAllister College and engaging some of our lower income and communities of color in this conversation. And it's really interesting to think about, you know, how do we help develop the social networks, that's what we kind of are calling it, of where community members are looking out for each other, because government's not going to be able to do it all. We saw it many years ago in Chicago when they had the extreme heat days that a number of people died from heat exhaustion, but most of those were people that were, you know, were shut-ins. They didn't have anybody checking in them. They might have been, you know, disabled or other things. And so how can we work with community groups and others to try to start to develop these social networks where people are being able to be more prepared? I mean, it's a goofy thing, but when we have big rain events, we need residents to help us clean the storm drains out, because those storm drains have to handle the water. But if they're all plugged up with leaves and grass and things like that from the downed trees, that's going to impact the ability for them to function. And you saw that in a huge way in Duluth when they had big storm damage down and the storm drains just blew out and then the whole road collapsed. So I'm sorry, Tom's giving me the high sign. So we can have more conversations. The mayor, I forgot to mention this, when we went to Paris, he was there as part of this group initiative, a Mississippi Rivers and Towns initiative. So it was mayors along the Mississippi River, and we really wanted to highlight the impact on the Mississippi River. So that first picture was really important. A lot of the attention's been on coastal cities, and river basins are really going to be impacted. 20 million people drink from the Mississippi River every day. So if we don't have water, what's that impact going to be on that? And we saw some of those problems in Flint, Michigan, but you know, there's communities around the world. I mean, and it's International Women's Day. But I think that the average woman in developing countries walks 5 miles carrying a couple of gallons of water on her head so that her family will be able to have safe water and drinking water. So those are the things that were kind of all connected. And so the mayor was able to have some of these conversations with communities in the Sudan, along the Nile, and in the Rhine, and talking about what are some of our common problems and common solutions that we can work together on. So with that, my little hopeful picture. I love bald eagles. I love birds. So when I was young, you know, bald eagles were going to be extinct. So we have, I think, about a dozen pairs of nesting bald eagles in St. Paul right now. So there is, if we all work together, we can really make impactful change and make a difference. So thank you very much.
Yeah, let's have one more big round of applause for this group, because they really did it. And one thing I appreciated very much was we had a little conference call before this session and talked a bit about what to do and how to get specific a bit, what's going on at the state level, what Excel is doing, what's going on in the cities, and kind of bring all this together, and I think they did an excellent job of doing that, and I appreciate that very much. So now let's have some questions and discussions. We've got a microphone here. Just raise your hand if you have some questions about anything, any of these topics. And obviously we covered a lot of ground from nuclear power to stormwater in St. Paul, and it's all fair game, and the president in China and India, and it's all fair game, so let's have at it.
How do you guys feel about policies like taxing carbon emissions and subsidizing clean energy?
Who wants to talk about, Ellen, you want to start in?
Sure,
talk about taxing carbon emissions?
Well, those are great questions. So about taxing carbon emissions or about subsidizing clean energy. And, you know, I think a lot of economists, including a lot of really conservative economists, would say that climate change is an example of one of the worst market failures in human history. And that's because we haven't done a good job of setting up although we've had a really great energy system that's enabled a really high quality of life at a reasonable price, and it's been very reliable. It hasn't done a good job of accounting for the costs of the pollution, which are not incorporated into the prices. So we pay nice, reasonably low prices for energy sources, for our gas, for our electricity, compared to a lot of parts of the world. But the impacts, the negative external impacts or externalities of those fossil fuel resources are not accounted for. Now, in Minnesota, we do have a law that requires that utilities have to look at the external costs or the externalities of their fuel choices when they look at their resource plans that Julia was talking about. So that's a start towards accounting for the cost of pollution from our energy usage. But I do think that we need a price on carbon one way or another at the national and global level to really get a handle on this problem. I'm not king of the world, so I don't get to make that happen. And obviously, it's politically a difficult topic. But I think there's more and more people on different sides of the political spectrum who think that it makes sense to either have a carbon tax or a carbon cap. But we'll see. It's not going to happen anytime soon politically. But some states are contemplating that. And some British Columbia is one of the provinces of Canada that's actually instituted a carbon tax, and it's been relatively successful. In terms of clean energy, subsidies for clean energy, really, if you go and look at the subsidies for different kinds of energy through the last century in America, it's clear that by far the bulk of those incentives, whether they're tax incentives or other kinds of incentives that are paid for with federal or state money, have gone to fossil fuels or nuclear energy, and a relatively small amount to renewable or clean energy. That started to shift in the last couple of years. That under the Obama administration, it was a big priority to increase support for renewable energy. But, you know, honestly, if you got rid of all subsidies for all energy, I think renewable energy would become probably come out on top, because the markets are set up so that, or if you had a carbon tax, it would allow renewable energy to be much more, it would be seen as the most economical choice under every circumstance. Right now, it's getting to be the economical choice in a lot of markets and under a lot of scenarios, but there's still some market barriers there. Anybody else want to add to that?
Some other comments on those issues?
No, I mean, the Obama administration did extend the federal tax credit for the solar, which I think was great. I think some of the efforts with the Solar America Cities and the Department of Energy a few years ago was to try to figure out how, with the price of solar, to get it more on parity with some of the traditional energy sources. And so for cities, our partnership was to try to look at how to streamline permitting, increase workforce development, some of those things. So sometimes the incentives may not necessarily be cash, but like trying to make it easier to be able to do things like that.
All right, other questions or follow up? Yes. You're doing fine, yep.
Okay, one thing that we've—
Hold it close.
Okay, in my classes, we've been talking a lot about environmental justice and injustice and environmental racism, which comes in to play as a huge part of climate change, especially in Minnesota, the downstream effect of the Mississippi River and how what is happening here is hugely affecting the coastal cities down south, as well as just like the management of the river, which is like the dredging and the levying and the damming. And just because some of these effects aren't happening in our own backyard, it's not talked about enough here because we don't see the coastal land loss. But it's happening to people down south all the time, and the issue of kind of ignoring the people who are really impacted by environmental issues, the socioeconomic status determining, you know, where you're living and how close you are to power plants, or, you know, how much park and recreation access you have in your neighborhood, or how well, like in Flint, clean water gets to your city. Can you guys touch a little bit on those issues?
Comments on the whole?
Sure, I mean, I can start a little bit. I mean, racial equity is a key priority of our city that we've been working on hard, and I think some of the work right now, what we're doing in our planning, which I, again, didn't have enough time, but we've been trying to look at an equity map for the city and the county and by census tract, and so that's very much a mindful piece of our planning, because if we have power outages in communities where, say, we the houses don't have, you know, electricity, they don't have air conditioning, they don't have any canopy cover, you know, we have a power outage and high temperature above 90 degrees, you know, we're likely to have some very vulnerable people because they're not going to have any natural ways to cool their homes with the shading of the trees. So that's going to, you know, it's one example of kind of how we're trying to think about that. The Mississippi River and Towns Initiative that the mayor's been participating in is a bipartisan group of mayors all along the Mississippi River, so they're from blue states and red states. And it's interesting to hear them talk, because the impact of, you know, erosion and sedimentation and the, you know, apexia in the Gulf is very much part of their piece, and a large part of it is coming from the Minnesota River. You know, obviously Mayor Coleman's been very supportive of the governor's efforts to try to work with farmers on the agricultural buffer strips and things like that. But the mayors are having these conversations. It's interesting to see, you know, when the mayor went to Paris, we had those heavy rains in December. And I don't know if people were tracking, but the lower Mississippi flooded. It had record floods in towns. The mayor, one of the mayors that accompanied the mayor, Coleman, to Paris, was from Natchez, Mississippi. It's a 300-year-old town. It's celebrating their tricentennial this year. 15,000 people had the, you know, their second record flood in the history of their community.
If I can ask a question from here, or other panelists as well. So I hear a lot of talk about the mayors are meeting, they're talking, they're doing this, they're studying it, do that. So how do we solve the problem? What's going on besides talk and analyze?
Yeah, right now they're in D.C. trying to lobby for some money from the federal government for planning for cities to do resiliency planning on climate change. And so, but they're hoping that their voices working together in a bipartisan way will be able to help, you know, break the gridlock.
Get some resources.
Yep.
Let me just add a couple things. One is, in Paris, with 196 countries there, all gathered together, I mean, literally, there were countries that were represented there who don't know if their land will still be there in a decade or so, because they're small island nations. And so we heard firsthand from a lot of parts of the world where climate change is so real and so imminent, and they really were kind of fighting for this 1.5 degrees target and started this high ambition coalition, which kind of peer pressure. I remember, so this is not really, I don't know if this counts as action, but it was, transformation was happening. Midway between the 2 week long climate talks, I remember running into at this sort of VIP event, running into one of the U.S. top negotiators for climate change and saying, well, I just heard that Germany and France just agreed to be part of this high ambition coalition to join forces with the small island nations and support a 1.5 degree target, which would take very significant carbon reduction to get there. And I was like, do you think the U.S. will join? He said, no, I don't think so. A week later, the U.S. was part of this and was helping to lead the charge for this. And that just went to show, I think, how much the power of the persuasion of all these people coming together made a difference. So I think leaders need to hear those stories and understand the dire nature of those impacts to take action. Let me give you one very specific thing that I'm aware of that's going on. So when we talk about climate justice and environmental justice, it's kind of about the goods and the bads. So the bads is the environmental impacts of emissions, pollution, landfills, hazardous waste, other things that are sited near the most vulnerable communities, or the health impacts, or their living conditions are disproportionately impacted. But what about the goods? What about the opportunity to put solar on your roof? What about the opportunity for those green jobs we were talking about earlier? How do we make sure that those are also equitably available to people who maybe don't have the advantages that everybody else has, or are facing some of those impacts? So there's one thing that we're working on in the state right now. The Public Utilities Commission asked for people to say, to come back with ideas for how we can have this new community solar program to serve low-income Minnesotans. How can people who don't have a lot of money to invest in solar and to also at the same time fix the leaks in their, you know, in their leaky house, you know, that doesn't have great insulation, how can you help them be able to get some of the benefits of this clean energy transition? So we're working on some really innovative pathways and policy ideas and financing tools to help make that happen in Minnesota right now. So that's exciting.
Are there questions? There you go. The gentleman right over here in the aisle. How's that?
Hi.
Oh, okay. Well, go ahead.
We've heard a lot about how the government and like Minnesota state government and the federal government are working with corporations and setting laws for corporations. But how is the government educating people? Because you said that the top-down strategy didn't work on a global level. How do you expect a top-down policy to work on a local level? So we have these, the main population, they go to work, they drive to work, they use the electricity that is being provided, which the government is working with corporations to make more environmentally safe. But there are people that aren't educated enough to even believe that global warming is happening. What is the government doing to help, or like the city officials doing to help educate these people and bring an environmental awareness to people, not only in their small community, but also to a global consciousness?
We have some quick answers to that.
Sure. I mean, I alluded on it a little bit, and I can give you some more reference. We worked with McAllister with some target neighborhoods, and we put together a Ready Resilience Guide, and we did some target grant, little grants for them about educating people about climate change, but then also about what preparedness things that they could have. And I know some of it sounds maybe too simplistic, but a lot of it, when we have these big storm events, it's going to be basic things about having water, bottled water, batteries, a way to charge your cell phone, an emergency plan for your family, things like that. And we're really trying, and we also did an effort where we were doing some mapping in the community where the community assets are for them, so they know a place that they could go that would be safe. You know, where are the food places, where are the churches, where are the rec centers, that kind of stuff. So I agree with you, it's, you know, it is a big challenge. And, you know, in St. Paul, we are also been, you know, really working on, I'm sorry, I'll stop right now. I realize I'm taking up too much time, but we'll, yeah.
And educating folks a little bit, and if so, what is it?
Sure. Well, I mean, we have a lot of programs around energy efficiency for customers, so we have some, you know, requirements that Ellen alluded to in terms of increasing energy efficiency and reducing sales. So we do a lot of work in households one-on-one to educate folks on ways that they can reduce their energy usage. I'd say at a little bit broader scale, and Anne referenced this a little bit, we are certainly seeing, you know, we're responsive, like I said, to those state and federal policies, but seeing increasingly communities having more demands for us, both individual customers, but then cities and communities really developing plans like Anne spoke to in terms of climate action plans or greenhouse gas emissions reduction plans. And so figuring out ways that we can respond to that sort of bottom up, you know, community interest and decisions going forward, how to help communities achieve those goals as well, based on what are pretty significant impacts in terms of what our electricity generation fleet looks like.
Professor Anderson must have some thoughts.
So he's trying to say more, but yeah.
I wanted to clarify. I guess I wasn't speaking on, like, because I understand that probably most people on this panel are liberals. What are you doing to, I mean, there's other people, this is like you're outreaching to the people who want to be outreached to. You're setting out small community plans. What about the people that don't want to face the issue? Like, a lot of conservatives don't want to face the issue of climate change. They don't want to believe in the climate change, what, like, how, like, because a lot of them are the people who are in the business. They work at the electrical plant. They work in the aluminum industry. They work in the coal industry. And it's like their livelihood depends on these things, but they use and they don't understand that what is happening now in the weather, they don't believe it has anything to do with what they with their day-to-day activities and what their profession does to the environment.
So a lot of topics here, but let me just say, I'll try to say three things. One, policy does matter, and I guess, so I'm going to go back to where you started quickly to say that policy does drive the changes that you've seen in Minnesota in a lot of ways, what the utilities do, et cetera, from the top down. So that does matter, but I think that what happens at the grassroots is just as important, and that's where often the rubber hits the road and the implementation of solutions happen. So it's going to take every individual to change this situation. But I'm really glad you brought up kind of politics, because I wanted to make sure we mentioned that today. I mean, I go back to my political mentor, Paul Wellstone. It's kind of a triangle: policy, politics, and the grassroots. Those are the three ways that big changes happen. And we can't ignore politics and the fact that, you know, half the government doesn't, or a big part of the government in Washington doesn't agree that climate change is real or that it's a problem or that we should do anything about it. And so we don't have that political consensus that, you know, those 196 countries have, which is sad to me, but it's a reality. So what do we do? And I guess a few things. One is we have to educate ourselves. You know, we all know there's an election going on and there's a million debates going on, and it's pretty clear, I think, if you want to check where the candidates all stand on these issues. And so it's really up to every American to educate themselves on that and to vote that way, and not just at the national level, but at the state level and at the local level, because those decision makers are going to determine a lot of the issues that we talked about, whether they move forward, whether they get stronger, or whether they disappear and go away. But I would say what makes me optimistic is that, number one, a majority of Americans, if you look at the polling, it's clear year after year. And people, you know, they look around, they see what's going on. A majority of Americans say climate change is real and it's a problem and we need to do something. And I think also a majority of Americans say that they would rather have us invest in more clean, renewable energy resources. And so I think we have the pieces in place to move forward, and we have to make sure that communities like Appalachian coal mining communities have a way to move forward and have a future that's good for them too. And so that's a piece of the responsibility, but I think that can certainly be done. And there's a lot that can be done at the grassroots level to try to bring people together. I think at the local level, things tend to be a little bit less partisan and more sort of action-oriented. I want to say there's kind of this big movement in the Tea Party to say there's a woman in Georgia who was a national founder of the Tea Party, which is about as conservative as you can get. But she founded something called the Green Tea Coalition because she wants to fight for the right to own solar and she wants for a clean energy economy, and she wants to get conservatives to see that this is a good thing. So there's a lot of really interesting political things going on. I want to say one more thing. There's an organization I'll just recommend called CERTS, Clean Energy Resource Teams. You can go on the internet. They're Minnesota-based. They're an example of a local organization. They're not political. They help people in communities move towards their clean energy projects, and they work collaboratively with people from all different political stripes. So look up CERTS, CERTS.
Thank you. A question right back there.
Yeah, so you kind of touched on, I was going to ask about how to go from a scientific community consensus to a political consensus. So I'll go kind of to my other question of, one of my professors went to the Paris Climate Conference, and said that he was pleased at the outcome of the conference, but disappointed that a lot of the consensuses were because renewables became financially viable versus the actual like social benefits. So I'm wondering if there's any way to kind of, if you could know of any examples of nonpartisan collaboration where the finances maybe weren't as favorable, but for altruistic reasons, and obviously saving the environment is kind of like one of the biggest ones that I'm thinking of, where that there was like a success, kind of. Because I know, at least with Sherco, a lot of the reason that was successful was financial viability, and I feel like the city partnership with XL was largely policy, and I don't really feel like XL would have done that otherwise. So I'm wondering, how can we move faster than the financial viability of renewables, I guess?
Well, just to speak to that briefly and maybe a little bit following up on this question too, is that, I mean, the plan that we've laid out that includes retiring 2 units of Sherco and adding all these renewables is cost effective, and that's how we can do that plan. I mean, we operate as a regulated utility and also one that's responsible for keeping customer rates, you know, manageable, for managing customer rates. So I think that in terms of the way we make decisions, it is in a lot of ways going to be driven by that for these broader decisions. But you referenced the Clean Energy Partnership, which is the partnership we have with the city of Minneapolis, and that we've sort of replicated or worked with other communities through a model called Partners in Energy as well. So again, this response to, there was a significant effort in Minneapolis around looking at municipalization, so whether or not they wanted to renew the franchise agreement with XL, and kind of pushing for the utility to be more responsive to those city, to the city scale goals around climate impacts. And so, yeah, that was definitely not, I mean, it was economic for us in that there was the franchise agreement was sort of what we were negotiating on, but also certainly we, you know, need to serve, be responsive to and serve the communities that are our customers. And so there was, I think, what's ended up to be a really positive outcome in terms of the way that we've been able to work with Minneapolis and sort of create a model there for the ways that we work more closely with our cities and communities to be a little more responsive and more personable in that way, and really build those relationships and support community level goals. So yeah, I would say that was driven by a lot of things and is a good example for what we're looking to move towards more in terms of customer responsiveness. So I don't know if that answers your question directly, but sort of melding those together.
Can I say one little thing? Because I just want to recognize my student who just asked the question. And he's part of a class and a project at the University of Minnesota that is working on trying to find or put together and create proposals for the University of Minnesota to invest in solar. And part of what the students realize and have to figure out is how to make it be a good choice for the university, cost effective, you know, not going to raise tuition, good for meeting their climate goals and environmental goals, and sort of meet all of those different criteria. So that's all about how it really works in a big institution. So they're doing a great job.
Question right down here.
You're not representing the military, but I was part
of
the military.
Hold the mic pretty close if you would, everybody do that.
You're not representing the military, but I've been part of the military, and I heard from a speaker last week that the military uses more energy than 35 countries, different countries. And of course, they're proposing to do more, because we are fearful people, and even though we're the most armed people, we're very fearful people, and we are not going to back off of that. But it will mean more energy being used, and in my experience, it's wasteful. It is polluting. It is in so many different ways contributing to the pollution and the loss of renewable energies. And can any of you speak to that? Or?
Well, I know that the military has been they're one of the agencies that have been working really, really hard on doing energy efficiency pieces and reducing their energy loads, and then also, you know, working on advancing renewable energies. I think, you know, I don't know that statistic. Well, I just saw something about U.S. buildings, and the U.S. buildings use more energy than the entire country of India and the entire country of Japan. So I know everybody's really excited about renewables, but there's huge opportunities in reducing the energy consumption in all of our existing buildings. And I think that's one of the big challenges that are, and also big opportunities, I think, in the U.S. to reduce our carbon footprint. Yeah, you know, the other one is going to be transportation fuels and doing more, increasing the CAFE standards and having more fuel-efficient vehicles and cleaner vehicles is another piece. But and I'm sorry, I don't know much about the military.
Yeah, the Department of Defense in there, they have this quadrennial report that they put out that talks about security, and they've identified climate change as one of the biggest, if not the biggest, security threat around the world. And so in recent years, they've really, even though they're still involved in, you know, U.S. policy, which is very kind of connected into the oil-producing regions of the world, it's very tangled up in that. They are the biggest energy user in the U.S. for sure, and they have the Navy especially, and some of the other branches have implemented some really strong policies to convert to renewables because they identified that one of the biggest dangers to soldiers that are deployed overseas is actually moving fuel around. Moving the supply lines is one of the most dangerous things and caused a lot of loss of life of soldiers, and so they were trying to figure out how they could produce, you know, local on-site renewable energy and try to prevent that from being a risk. So they've been doing some good things and really helping to change the market because they have a lot of money to spend. And they've been trying to get, for example, biofuels that can be dropped in on, you know, to airplanes and Navy ships that can be used for alternative fuel resources. So,
interesting question. Very good question. Yeah, right down here. Well, let's take maybe one more question, or we can we'll get some real quick answers. Phyllis, Representative Kahn.
I'm Phyllis Kahn, the state legislator in this area. And I was glad Anne finally mentioned transportation. I don't think I had heard it earlier. But one of the things, of course, both campuses here are very good in large amounts of bicycle transportation. And so those things that we've done to promote that have clearly cut down the amount of cars that are used. But I was picking up on something that Julie said about XL being the biggest best user of wind energy, and it's related to bicycles because I've biked through most of Iowa many summers, and I've seen huge wind farms in Iowa. And how do we compare to the usage of wind in Iowa? I mean, I don't think I've seen anything quite that extensive in Minnesota.
The mic, Julia.
Sure. I Minnesota as a state, and I, you know, XL Energy as our position as the number one wind utility is across all eight states too, and that production is not in Minnesota. But I believe as a state, Minnesota is maybe in the top five. I mean, Texas, Iowa. We might have dropped
seventh or something like that. Now we used to be, we're somewhere, but I think Iowa's a little ahead of us now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we're in the top tier, let's say.
Yeah, and we do have great wind resources in Minnesota, as Ellen mentioned, especially in the southwest part of the state.
They did one thing Iowa did really well was really when the European countries were starting to get into wind energy big time and developing modern wind turbines in the last decade, and they looked to the U.S. to try to expand manufacturing of those wind turbine plants from, you know, companies from Denmark and Spain and other countries came and looked around, and Iowa really worked hard to recruit some of those companies, and so they got a lot of wind manufacturing, and, they have a market here in Minnesota they can sell it to because we have a strong mandate for buying it.
Right, we got one more question.
And I rode my bike
here tonight.
Here.
So. Oh, go ahead, Julia, if you want to quit. Go ahead.
Hi. I'm wondering, with XL Energy considering closing the Sherco plants in Becker, I'm wondering, are there any plans to put renewable infrastructure in Becker to replace it, as far as like job loss, mm-hmm. and to have like those jobs like switch over?
Sure. Yeah, we are looking at, I mean, we've started to look at some replacement options for what we would do for that Sherco capacity. And one of the proposals is to put 50 megawatts of solar on site. And so that we haven't, again, this is all sort of exploratory at this point where we're looking at those plans, but to look at putting a natural gas plant on site, but also putting some solar there. So recognizing that at this point, the way that our grid is planned, having that sort of a natural gas plant that we can control really easily will be important for maintaining grid reliability, but also putting solar there to add some capacity to the system in that area, and certainly to manage that job transition, because as Anne spoke about, we did close two metro coal plants in the last decade at Riverside and Highbridge, and were able to manage that job transition so that there weren't any job losses as a result. We were able to, either folks were nearing retirement or transition folks to other plants, and so that would certainly be the goal with Sherco, as well as really to minimize those socioeconomic impacts on the community, because we are a large employer and the largest property taxpayer in that area and in the state overall.
I think the magic hour of 8:30 has arrived, but I think also our speakers would maybe stick around for a moment or two. If people have questions, you can come up and ask them. Although you have one more question? We'll violate the rule here and do one quick question and quick answers. How's that?
XL is switching over from coal to natural gas. Are they accounting for methane emissions? I only saw carbon on the graph up there.
Yeah, I mean, so we're regulated on all of our emissions, so we certainly are planning to comply with any greenhouse gas emissions requirements around that, and minimize impacts. So from the plants directly, is that what you're referring to in terms of just methane emissions?
Yeah, there's a lot of methane leakage in the fracking process.
So for us, it's really based on what the emissions from the plant are directly. So there's that life cycle analysis stuff. I think there's some movement towards including that in some of the externality costs or some of these broader impacts, but right now it's really measured at the stack, the outputs from the plant directly. So we're not involved in natural gas extraction at all as a business. But.
All right, well, I thank the speakers again for doing a fine job. I thank all of you for coming here. This was an excellent discussion, I thought. And if I can just wrap it up with one or a couple of thoughts, my observations about it, particularly for the students that are here tonight, and I think that's the focus of all of these symposia that we have, is that we've talked a lot about world things, the United Nations and its role, and worldwide conferences. Now, we've talked about the state's role and trying to be XL Energy and have to deal with five different states and do all of that. We've talked about cities and the role of cities, and all these intergovernmental units is a topic that's always interested me a lot, how that works. And when you put all this together and talk about what we're adapting here now with changing the climate on climate Earth, it seems to me, for the students here, if you want to make a difference in your lifetime, well, you don't have to do it full-time or whatever, but there is an opportunity here, whether you go into science or economics or political science, marketing, all of these issues have come up here tonight in various ways. And I think you've got a big plethora of opportunities out there in different fields that all desperately need some thoughtful, good thinking to help bring all this about and meet these goals that the world came together and did in Paris. So good luck with all of that, and we hope we see you at the next symposium. Thanks for coming, everybody, and thanks to the panel.